Quest presents an unabridged recording of The Laird's Ladle by Yvonne Vincent, narrated by Angela Ness. Prologue, 12th April, 1746. Far out at sea, the ship was a dark shadow, a void where the men on the beach would expect to see stars or the reflection of faint moonlight on the water through the persistent light drizzle that was seeping into their kilts, causing the material to become heavy and stick to the backs of their legs. Despite the cold and the damp, the men had lit a signal fire and were in good spirits as they watched two small wooden boats approach the beach. The boats sat low in the water, their precious cargo weighing far more than the few men struggling to row against the tide. The rowers had urged the ship's captain to wait for the tide to turn, but he was anxious to deliver the caskets and head back to France before they were caught in the impending storm or by the British Navy, whose ships prowled the Scottish coast and had already intercepted Le Mars and La Bellone. The captain was under strict instructions from Louis XV to deliver the gold to Monsieur James Alexander Macrae, and after the losses sustained thus far, the French king would brook no failure. Thus, with a rising sense that any delay was tempting fate, the captain had ordered La Reine be steered as close as possible to the Isle of Vic, and the boats loaded. Grumbling, the men had complied, and back muscles straining against the pull of the waves, had set off towards the distant beach and the small knot of waiting Scotsmen. On the shore, there was similar grumbling, this time about the chances of successfully delivering the gold to Charles Stuart on the mainland.
"Look at the sea. We all know there's a storm coming. I canna see how we're going to get it to the mainland before we get cut off, James Alec."
James Alec, a man used to towering over others, looked up at his even larger friend.
"Ach, stopping such an old woman, Bruce," he snapped. "It's just a wee bit of rain and wind. We'll split it among the fishing boats. That way, if one is lost, hopefully the others will make it through. They've only got to get us as far as Peterhead."
"Aye, that's fine for you to say. You're not the one risking life and limb for the cause," Bruce muttered. "Speak for yourself. If anyone is caught, it'll be my head on a spike outside the Tower of London. So either stop your moaning or get yourself home to Mary and a fine tatty scone by your safe, warm fireplace."
Bruce shot James Alec a defiant glare. But the other man had already turned away and was signalling to the rest of the group to wade out with him and help pull the boats ashore. Some minutes later, a small cheer went up as the French sailors heaved themselves, exhausted, onto the sand. The group of Scotsmen, kilts tucked up and bare bottoms flashing pale in the moonlight, were hauling the boats the last few yards. With the ice-cold North Sea lapping at his knees, James Alec looked back at the solitary figure silhouetted against the dying light of the fire.
"Come on, Bruce," James Alec called. "Help us get the boats unloaded. It's that cold in here, my balls are trying to escape through my mouth."
Bruce stood unmoving, so James Alec tried again.
"I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said what I said. You know me and my big mouth."
"Aye, well, your wee balls would be rattling around in there."
Bruce held up his hands, made two tiny circles with his thumbs and forefingers and shouted,
"My balls are huge. I could put my balls in your mouth. That would fill it up."
The men at the boats stopped moving and, as one, turned towards Bruce, who, realising what he had just said, stiffened and attempted to backtrack.
No, I wasn't offering to, well, you ken me and my own big mouth."
He took a deep breath and ploughed on.
I'm sorry too. I'll help you unload."
He looked at the faces of the men who were still staring at him and clarified,
"Unload the boats, ye heathens."
The peals of laughter rang across the beach as Bruce tucked up his kilt and joined his companions in the freezing water, ignoring the good-natured cries of, "Keep your lips sealed, men!" A short while later, fortified by some good whiskey, the Frenchmen returned to the boats and made their way back to the ship. Surveying the collection of chests before him, James Alec reminded his men of the plan.
"We'll take this lot up to the cart at the top of the cliff path and I'll hide it overnight. If anything happens to me, Bruce is the secret keeper. He'll know where it's hidden and appoint a second secret keeper in case anything happens to him, and so on and so forth. We shouldn't need to do any of that because the plan is to load on to the fishing boats tomorrow. You'll go to Peterhead with the boats and meet up with the cart sent by the Mackenzies to take the load the rest of the way. There's enough gold in here to keep the army going for a good while. Any questions?"
A man at the back of the group raised his hand and James Alec sighed, knowing that nothing sensible was coming.
"Aye, Ian, what is it?" "Can I go with Brucie? If the boat's in trouble, I can think of a couple of things that would make good ballast."
Laughing, the group broke up, hoisted the chests onto shoulders and began to make their way up the cliff path, trudging upwards through the darkness, trying to keep their footing on the uneven ground. None of the men felt the wind change or noticed the faint moon disappearing as it was blanketed by a thicker layer of cloud. By the next morning, the fishing boats in the bay were ragged things, straining at their moorings, battered by the unrelenting wind and waves. There would be no sailing to Peterhead that day. In fact, thanks to the ferocity of the storm, there would be no sailing anywhere for a week. Shortly after daybreak, the men began to arrive at Bruce's cottage, a small stone building huddled against the wind on the side of the bleak, rocky hill. One by one, they made their way up the muddy track, leaning into the wind as it whipped through gaps in the dry-stained dikes either side of them, swearing as feet slipped on stones and mud splashed the backs of their kilts. Eventually, the group stood in front of Bruce's fireplace, backsides gently steaming, grumbling good-naturedly as Mary nudged them aside so she could turn the bannocks on the griddle, suspended over the fire. Declaring it too early for the whiskey, she bustled off to find some ale and the men got down to business.
"It's clear we'll not get to Peterhead today. What's the plan?"
asked Ian. Bruce spread his arms wide and shrugged.
"I dinna ken, lads. Did you see James Alec on your way here? He left an hour ago to check on the..."
Bruce looked around to check whether Mary was in earshot.
"You ken what?" he whispered.
A voice shouted through from the back of the house.
"I know what ye mean. I do have ears, Bruce Duckett. You and James Alec are not as discreet as you think when you're in your cups. Blood oath of secrecy. My..."
"Thanks, Mary,"
Bruce called back, rolling his eyes at the men.
"Now, if you've any idea where James Alec is, maybe you could share that with the rest of us."
Mary came through and stood, hands on hips, frowning at the men.
"Sounds to me like you should be out there looking for him instead of standing around here ruining my bannocks with the steam off your arses."
Reluctantly, the men agreed to venture back outside and brave the foul weather in search of their leader. After all, he couldn't have gone far. They agreed to split up and meet back at the cottage in an hour. Bruce was the first one back. He stumbled through the door, bringing with him a blast of wind that scattered the straw on the floor. His dark hair was matted, and drops of rain and sweat mingled to form a salty sheen on his flushed cheeks. In his arms was a large bundle, covered by a long woolen cloak.
"Mary," he gasped, "I found him! Oh, God save us, I found him!"
As Mary came running through to the front room, Bruce laid a bundle gently on the floor and peeled the cloak back to reveal the body of James Alexander McCrae, his childhood friend who, through sheer determination and loose family connections, had raised himself up from shepherd to friend of the Mackenzies and confidant to the prince himself. James Alec McCrae had been wild and confident and, at times, breathtakingly reckless. Quick to laugh and slow to anger, he was trusted and loved by all who met him. And now he was no more. Now he was a cold and bloody corpse, a spark forever extinguished. Mary ran to her husband's side as he sat hunched over the body. She put her arms around him, murmuring words of comfort. But he felt stiff and unyielding. They sat there on the floor by the fire, and the still figure of their friend as the other men slowly returned to the cottage. Biting back his tears, Bruce growled,
"He was in a ditch over at Hillside Farm. He's been stabbed in the chest more than once, I think. Whoever did this must have been after the gold, which means it was one of us. Nobody else kent about the gold."
He looked up at the group, and they shifted uncomfortably, casting their eyes downwards to avoid his furious glare. Eventually, Ian cleared his throat and asked,
I don't mean to be indelicate, but is the gold still there?"
Bruce turned on him wild-eyed.
"Why would you ask that, Ian? Is the gold more important than the man? Do you have something you'd like to confess to the rest of us?"
Ian looked away and said,
"No, we've known each other since we were bairns, Bruce. You surely think better of me than that."
Bruce relented and sighed.
"Aye, I do. And I would not think it of you if it was not the case that someone here must have done this terrible deed."
Ian raised his hands in supplication.
"I was thinking of how he'd want us to finish the task."
"You're right. Whatever happened out there at the farm, he didn't tell where he'd stashed the gold. It's still there, but it will soon be moved to somewhere more secure. You have my word on that. The man who did this will not profit by his misdeeds. You may all go now," said Bruce stiffly. "I have to arrange the burial of my friend."
Silently, the men slipped out of the cottage, drew their cloaks around them, and, the wind at their backs, made their way home. In the years that followed, rumours ran throughout the island, becoming ever more fanciful in the telling. Some blamed Bruce Duckett, saying the two had fallen out over treasure, although nobody was quite sure how the sons of a shepherd and a crofter would possess such a thing. Some said that James Alec had stolen from the prince himself and had been killed as an act of revenge. However, the murderer was never caught, and devastated by the loss of his childhood friend, Bruce shut himself away and took to the whisky. As for the location of the treasure, that remained a mystery. Bruce never spoke of it. Shortly after the storm abated, word reached the island of the defeat at Culloden. Messages were sent from the prince to arrange for the gold to be delivered to the mainland. But even among the tight-knit group of men who had carried it up from the beach, there was uncertainty as to who was now the secret keeper, and whether the gold ever made it off the island. Over the centuries, the legend grew of French gold buried somewhere on the Isle of Vic, and the murder of James Alec McCrae was all but forgotten. Only a small cross in the undergrowth, behind a stone cottage at the foot of a bleak hill, marked his passing.
Chapter 1. Vic Herald. 12th April. Rising stars begin filming on Vic. Filming has begun on the Isle of Vic for Hollywood blockbuster The Rising. The cast and crew arrived last week, among them legendary actor Johnny Munro, who plays the lead, and Alex Moon, ex-husband of Vic's own Penny Moon. They are supported by a horde of local people who have volunteered as extras. With their sword-fighting prowess, battle reenactment group The Warrior Islanders were recruited to play minor roles as loyal followers of Johnny Munro's character, Alistair MacDonald of Glengarry, also known as Pickle the Spy. "Johnny's a lovely man. He'll do anything for a jube-jube. He gobbles them up and leaves empty bags wherever he goes,"
said Mary Hopper, Alex Moon's former mother-in-law and a leading light in the Warrior Islanders. The making of the movie on Vic has reignited interest in the Vic treasure. It has long been believed that a French ship bearing French and Spanish gold, destined for Bonnie Prince Charlie, sank off the island during a storm in 1745. There are no contemporaneous records of the ship, but legend has it that at least some of the gold made it ashore and is buried somewhere on the island. The story is lent some credence by the discovery of a ring bearing the seal of Mary Queen of Scots at Hillside Farm last year. As a result of this and the filming, the islanders are looking forward to a higher than usual number of visitors this year. Visit Scotland has advised that already hotels and bed and breakfasts are fully booked until October. Captain Kev, co-owner of the local ferry, recommends that day trippers book their tickets early. Vic has also been in the news recently following the arrest of Araminta Hubbard for a mass poisoning. Click here for more on the chiller killer. Update, 13th April. The Vic Herald offers its sincere apologies to Johnny Munro for any offence caused by yesterday's article. We have since been informed that, as well as being an Aberdeenshire term for a fruity sweet, jube-jube is an urban slang for a small penis. Penny clicked off the article and scrolled down her contacts until she came to D. Dragon. Annoying old. She listened to the ringing at the other end and imagined Mary Hopper rummaging through the handbag of doom. Pulling her phone out from under a pile of tissues, an interesting rock, cat toothpaste and a battered copy of The Big Blue Jobby.
"Hello, Chunky," said Mary. "Have you freed Mrs Hubbard yet? I bought the loveliest scarf in Marks and Spencer's today. It's blue with red flowers. I was going to buy it for you, but I liked it so much that I bought it for me instead. Will you finish in time for lunch?"
"Jube Jube's mum," Penny tutted. "You did that on purpose."
"I have no idea what you're talking about."
"You know exactly what I'm talking about. I distinctly remember you snickering like a teenager when Edith told Hector he'd never get another boyfriend with a jube-jube like his."
"Oh, well, right. But that vile man deserves everything he gets. When the nice boy from the paper called asking for a quote, well, I couldn't help myself. Only don't tell your father. He's still annoyed with me for accidentally sexting Rabbi Hoffman. Honestly, it was such an easy mistake to make. Len Hopper and Leo Hoffman."
"Which reminds me, Mum, did you pick up your new glasses from the optician?"
"Yes, but I do think you're all making quite a fuss about nothing."
Penny heard a rustle and some clicks, then her phone pinged. She opened the text to find a photograph of her mother wearing a pair of lurid pink horn-rimmed spectacles. In the background, she could see Sandra next door glaring furiously at a young woman behind a counter.
"Where are you?" Penny asked her mum. "We're in the fabric shop. Sandra next door is making me a kilt. The one they made for the film is very unflattering, and really, if I'm starring in this thing, I want to look my best."
"You only have one line," said Penny, exasperated.
"It's a very important line," Mary replied. "They can hardly go off to war without their porridge. And how will we ever know if anyone wants porridge unless I ask? Would you like some porridge? They could lose the entire battle for want of a bowl of porridge."
Penny silently cursed her ex-husband for getting Mary a speaking part. She had been insufferable ever since. Her father was at home, ill in bed, and in no fit state to curb Mary's worst excesses. His own excesses, i.e. his love of Mrs. Hubbard's ice cream, had been his undoing. "Newsflash," Penny told her mother. "We lost at Culloden. Listen, I'll call you as soon as we know what's happening with Mrs. Hubbard. Just enjoy your day out at the Aberdeen shops." Penny disconnected the call and returned to the bank of plastic seats, where Elsie sat huddled in an oversized beige cardigan, as if trying to blend in with the dismal café au lait theme that some deluded designer had thought fitting for the modern police station. She assumed it was supposed to feel calming and neutral, something to soothe the nerves of anxious people trapped in this waiting area, unsure of what was going to happen to them or their loved ones. Instead, the magnolia walls with their light brown painted circles sucked the light out of the place, leaving the room cast in a sickly glow reminiscent of the pictures Penny had seen of old public buildings from the 1970s. The effect was only amplified by the dark green utilitarian linoleum and the glass wall, behind which three women acted as gatekeepers of the large grey door leading to the custody suite. Somewhere beyond those doors sat Mrs. Hubbard, frightened and alone. Penny fervently hoped that someone had told her that she and Elsie were here.
"Is Mary okay?" asked Elsie.
"Yes, it was a good idea to ask Sandra next door to babysit her. Poor Dad's not fit to argue if she comes home with five pairs of tap shoes and declares she's turning his shed into a dance studio." Elsie paled.
"She wouldn't do that, would she? Where would we put the, you know what?"
She glanced around, checking for cameras, and added,
"Shh, they've probably got the place bugged so they can catch people incriminating themselves."
Penny laughed. "You've been working in the library for too long. Too many spy novels. Don't worry, the you know what will be fine, and Mum's notions fade as quickly as they start. Last week she was all for creating a donkey sanctuary called Ass Lovers. Dad had to have a word with Captain Rab and Captain Kev to stop her bringing 10 of them over on the ferry." Elsie gave her a tight smile. She disapproved of Mary and her notions. Len was a far steadier character, dependable and always ready to lend a hand, whether it was fixing something or growing you-know-what to ease the aches and pains of the local pensioners. You could count on Len Hopper. Elsie felt that she and Len were kindred spirits, both quiet types with a steel core. Like her, he was happy to stay in the background, but would fight his corner if necessary. She supposed that was why Len and Mary Hopper had stayed the course. Someone had to rein the woman in, yet Mary's unpredictability probably kept Len on his toes. Elsie wondered if her life was perhaps too quiet. Since her Archie died, she hadn't really done anything but go to work at the library, do her rounds in the van, and go to Losers Club for some company once a week. Sometimes she'd take a sherry at the pub with Minty Hubbard, but the place was full of bright young things, and she was very conscious that she looked out of place. This dreary old woman with her perm and her beige mac. Elsie thought she would like to be a little more exciting, except she didn't know where to begin. Perhaps she wasn't so much disapproving of Mary's notions as a little jealous. "Are you thinking about poor Mrs. Hubbard?" Penny asked.
"Yes," Elsie lied. "How much longer do you think they'll hold her?"
"Mrs. Taylor died," said Detective Inspector Mitchell, "and you still deny any knowledge. So far, 46 islanders who ate your ice cream have become seriously ill, including our own Sergeant Wilson. And we don't take kindly to our own people being poisoned. Isn't that right, DC Can?"
The detective constable, who thus far had been relegated to note-taking and daydreaming while the inspector enjoyed a good rant, started at the sound of her own name.
"That's right, sir. We don't take kindly to poisoning police officers." "It's my retirement due tonight, and this woe is me act is getting very old indeed. Isn't that right, DC Can?"
"That's right, sir. You're very old indeed," said the DC, who, believing her role in proceedings was over, had momentarily slipped back into trying to recall what time her supermarket delivery was arriving that evening. All this talk of ice cream was making her hungry.
D.I. Mitchell shot her a malevolent look and continued, "The lab has confirmed salmonella. Either you're negligent or you deliberately set out to poison your friends and neighbours. Which is it, Mrs. Hubbard?"
Mrs. Hubbard buried her face in her hands and through her sobs wailed, "I don't know. I don't know how it happened. I make all my ice cream with strict hygiene. The certificate is on the wall of the shop. My Douglas will show you."
"Well, I'm sure he would if he wasn't in Vic Hospital after eating 3 cones of strawberry choc chip while watching reruns of Strictly Come Dancing," Inspector Mitchell hissed. "The lab results show that the salmonella came from your ice cream."
Mrs. Hubbard sobbed even harder, seeing the detective inspector puff himself up to new heights of outrage. Her solicitor interrupted with a sharp,
"D.I. Mitchell, my client is clearly distressed. Now might be a good time for a break."
D.I. Mitchell deflated slightly and nodded.
"Aye, interview suspended. The time is 12:46.
He reached over to switch the recorder off, and as he did so, there was a rap on the door. The D.I. barked,
"What?"
And a young uniformed PC appeared.
"Sorry to interrupt, sir," he said nervously. "There's a fresh report in from the lab that you'll want to see."
With a sigh, the D.I. scraped back the chair and drew himself up to his full height. At 6'2", and carrying his fair share of middle-aged spread, he dominated the space. Looming menacingly over his elderly suspect, he growled,
"I'll be there in a minute. Take this one back to her cell."
With DC cans scuttling behind him, the DI ducked through the doorway, leaving behind him only the sound of a sobbing woman. As the PC hovered uncertainly, the solicitor gave his client a kindly pat on the arm.
"Now there, Mrs. Hubbard, let's just see what this new lab report says."
He helped her to her feet, and as she wobbled slightly, the PC reached out to steady her.
"If you come with me," the constable told her, "I'll get you a nice cup of tea. Well, it won't be nice because it comes from the machine. It'll be quite horrible, actually. But I know there's a packet of jammy dodgers, so at least you'll have a biscuit to go with it. Only don't tell DC Can. They're her jammy dodgers."
He smiled encouragingly at Mrs. Hubbard and gently guided her out of the interview room towards the custody suite. She looked back at her solicitor, her cheeks still wet with tears, and said,
"Will you tell Penny and Elsie not to wait any longer for me?"
Her solicitor nodded,
"For all the good it will do."
Back in the waiting area, Penny and Elsie were pacing to and fro under the watchful eye of the woman behind the front desk. Elsie had declared that the plastic chairs were cutting off the circulation to her legs and had begun hobbling around the room, wincing and muttering about pins and needles in her corns. After a futile attempt to get the front desk lady to provide more information on what was happening to Mrs. Hubbard, Penny had joined her. Both came to a sudden halt when the doors leading to the inner sanctum of the police station swung open and Mrs. Hubbard's solicitor strode out.
"Any news?" asked Penny.
"We're taking a break," the solicitor told her. "She's asked me to tell you not to wait for her."
"Not wait!" exclaimed Elsie. "I've been her friend for 50 years. If she thinks I can't spare a few more hours, well, tell the silly woman I'll be here as long as it takes. You can go if you want to, Penny."
"I'm staying too. I've been her friend for a while. Anyway, I'm staying."
"How long do you think it'll take?"
The solicitor looked at the pair over the top of his spectacles and rubbed a hand over his thinning dark hair.
"I'll be honest, they know the salmonella came from her ice cream and she's admitted to making it. There's a good chance they'll charge her, in which case she'll remain in custody until she appears in court tomorrow morning."
"But Mrs. Hubbard wouldn't deliberately poison anyone," Penny protested.
"Even if it's not deliberate, they'll say she was negligent. Mrs. Taylor died, so they're not going to let her off with a slap on the wrist.
We're still waiting for the full post-mortem, but there was half a tub of strawberry whirl and a dead dog with its muzzle covered in ice cream next to her. The solicitor pushed his glasses back up his nose. I doubt she'll be out today. You may as well go home. Penny was starting to think he was right. She was just about to say so when she saw Elsie stiffen beside her.
We're staying, said Elsie, crossing her arms and glaring defiantly at the solicitor. It's your job to make sure Minty is not charged. And just so we're clear, that's what we're paying you for. We'll take our lunch at the pub across the road, then we'll be back. Please keep us informed of any developments. Penny, give him your mobile cell thing number.
Penny knew that it was pointless to argue with Elsie. The woman was kind and quiet, but she was made of strong stuff. Meekly, she scribbled her mobile number on the flyleaf of her book, tore it off and handed it over. With an indignant sniff, Elsie tucked her arm into Penny's, spun them around and marched towards the front door of the police station. Goodness, thought Penny. For a woman with poor circulation and terrible corns, she's surprisingly nippy. The gavel and gallows was a shabby, old-fashioned relic, the patina of decades of cigarette smoke still clinging to what was once white anaglypta wallpaper. Over the years, thousands of feet had worn a scarred path in the linoleum between a piece of yellow tape on the floor and the darts board. The bare wood of the round tables, which had long lost their varnish, was polished smooth by thousands of elbows. At the back of the room was a small bar, behind which a barman stood, idly scratching his crotch. As they got their drinks, Penny asked the barman if the pub served lunch. He smiled, revealing a mouthful of what could only be described as nicotine-stained stubs, and handed her two burgundy faux-leather-covered menus. Back at the table, Penny opened hers and regarded with dismay the dog-eared piece of card in its plastic pocket. Scampi and chips, chicken and chips, fish and chips, or steak and chips. Which culinary delight with chips shall we have? She asked. Elsie thought for a moment, then flashed her a wicked grin.
I'm having the pizza and chips, but you should probably ask them to hold the chips. Mary's right. You're looking a bit broad around the beam again.
Penny wasn't quite sure what to say to this. On the one hand, as leader of her very own weight loss group, she should set an example. On the other hand, Elsie was a cheeky cow. If Jim was here, he'd laugh like a drain and spend the next week making jokes at her expense. He'd find every opportunity to point out a beam and ask her opinion as to its breadth. Just as well that he was currently at Hillside Farm helping Knight, a cranky, headstrong mare, give birth to her first foal. Between this and lambing, she'd hardly seen him since February. He had, however, kept up a steady stream of vet jokes by text. A ewe urinated on me this morning. It was quite embarrassing. Guess how I felt? Sheepish. Graham Christie's dog ate his desk lamp this morning. Graham's delighted. Graham Christie's dog ate a snake this morning. I've prescribed antihistamines. Tina Shaw has run up a huge bill for her cat's operation and doesn't know how to pay. I told her SpayPal would be fine. Penny smiled to herself and decided to have the chicken and chips. At least half the meal would be vaguely healthy. As she took the menus to the bar to place their orders, she briefly considered asking the barman if they did veg, but looking at the pallor of him, she suspected he hadn't eaten anything green since 1982, around the same time as he last had a shower. In fact, you could probably fry the chips in his hair. The thought made Penny feel slightly ill, and she crossed her fingers, hoping that someone else, someone clean, was doing the cooking. Maybe she wouldn't order the chips after all. Maybe this was how people stayed slim. Sod the healthy diet and exercise, chuck the degree in nutrition out the window. All she had to do was imagine every meal cooked by a pasty-looking, greasy fella in a manky Aberdeen football top, and the pounds would drop off. She decided not to pass this top tip on to her Losers Club members. After all, she needed the income, and folk would hardly pay their subscriptions if she rocked up with the barman in tow and said, "Right, imagine this guy picking his nose while he makes you a nice fry-up." Come to think of it, she wasn't sure she even wanted the chicken now. Half an hour later, Elsie was happily devouring her pizza while Penny pushed the culinary equivalent of shoe leather round her plate. In the end, she had eschewed chips and made a tentative inquiry as to the availability of vegetables. The result? Breaded Doc Martin in a sea of baked beans. Elsie eyed the plate.
"Do you want those beans because there's no point in them going to waste?"
Penny pushed the plate towards her and said, "For such a little person, you sure can put it away. I suppose we should count ourselves lucky. Poor Mrs. Hubbard is probably getting slops and gruel."
"Mince and tatties, actually," said a voice at the door.
Both women whipped round and instantly chairs were scraped back as they stood to greet the new arrival. Elsie scuttled over and, eyes brimming with tears, embraced her friend.
"Oh, Minty, I thought that next time we saw you, you'd be..."
She glanced around the room to check they were alone, lowered her voice and whispered,
"A lesbian."
Over her head, Mrs. Hubbard looked at Penny quizzically. Penny bit her lip, frowned and shrugged. Mum suggested she watch Orange Is the New Black to prepare her for visiting you in, prison. Sorry. The awkward silence which followed was eventually broken by Mrs. Hubbard, who put her head on Elsie's shoulder and began to wheeze. Her back heaved spasmodically, and at first Penny thought she was crying. It soon became clear, however, that she was laughing. Standing there in the doorway of the crappiest pub in Aberdeen, having been interrogated for hours by what must surely be the world's grumpiest policeman, Mrs. Hubbard howled with mirth.
"Oh, goodness," she said,
wiping her streaming eyes and leaning on Elsie for support.
"I needed that. I know it's very serious, everything that's happened. But can you imagine my Douglas if at the grand old age of 70-something I emerged from the cupboard? I don't know what you were thinking, Elsie."
Penny could see that the thought of her husband's reaction was about to set Mrs. Hubbard off again. So she gently unpeeled Elsie, who, still clinging to her friend, looked rather baffled by the sudden bout of hilarity, and steered them both towards the table. "What would you like to drink?" she asked, once they were seated. Mrs. Hubbard looked around the pub and grimaced.
"I don't suppose they do cocktails in here."
"Well, I'd pay good money to watch you ask the barman for a screaming orgasm," Penny commented wryly. Elsie tutted disapprovingly and said,
"For once in your life, just get a lemonade like a sensible person."
"Maybe I'll ask for a porn star martini," said Mrs. Hubbard defiantly.
The barman appeared and gave Mrs. Hubbard the full benefit of his rocky relationship with dentistry. Beaming widely at her, he winked and said,
"Nobody warned me an angel would come into my life today. What heavenly nectar can I get you?"
Somewhat discomfited, Mrs. Hubbard looked away, patted her silver curls and muttered,
"Just a lemonade, please."
Once they were settled with their drinks, both Penny and Elsie expressed their surprise at Mrs. Hubbard's sudden appearance. "From what your solicitor said, we weren't sure you'd be released at all," Penny explained.
"I was quite surprised myself, dearie," said Mrs. Hubbard. "They said the post-mortem came back on Mrs. Taylor, and they'd had another report in from the lab, which they wanted to follow up. To be honest, it would almost have been a relief to be charged and have this over and done with."
"You can't say that," Elsie told her firmly. "You haven't done anything wrong."
"It's clear my ice cream poisoned half the island. I must have done something wrong. I've agonised about it, but I can't think how it happened. I really didn't do anything differently. And poor Mrs. Taylor, to think that I'm responsible. I can hardly live with myself."
This time the tears were born of deep misery. Elsie produced a neatly folded white handkerchief from her bag and passed it to her friend.
There's no point in torturing yourself, she said then. Turning to Penny, she asked, will you call Mary and Sandra next door to let them know we can meet them?
Penny nodded and, pulling her phone from her pocket, went to sit at another table to make the call. She reckoned that Mrs. Hubbard and Elsie would appreciate a few minutes alone together. Once more, she dialed Dragon Annoyingly Old and heard the strident voice of a woman in full flow.
Not the flowery one, you silly woman, said Mary Hopper. The leopard skin next to it. Sorry, Chunky, we're looking at new wallpaper for the living room and Sandra next door has dreadful taste. Have you any news about Mrs. Hubbard?
That's why I'm calling. She's been released. They're still investigating and she's not off the hook, so please be sensitive when you see her.
As you well know, I'm the soul of discretion. Let's meet in... Hang on.
Penny held the phone away from her ear as her mother bellowed,
Sandra next door, are we still going to the shoe shop to get some high heels for your Jeff?
Penny could hear a faint voice in the background. Then her mother returned, sounding quite miffed.
Well, I don't know what's got her knickers in a twist. Never mind, we'll meet you in the Marks and Sparks Cafe in an hour.
Penny made another call, then returned to her friends. I've ordered a taxi, she told them. It'll be here in 5 minutes. Do you want to wait in here or outside?
Outside, if you don't mind, said Mrs. Hubbard. The fresh air will do me good.
As they rose to leave, the barman shuffled over, his eyes fixed on Mrs. Hubbard.
Leaving so soon? I was going to ask for your number. I am, as they say, a man of substance. A businessman and proprietaire.
He said the latter in a French accent, with a strong hint of Paisley.
Proprietaire.
He looked around and gestured at the bar.
Quite the catch for a lady of your years, and added bonus, I know somewhere we could go for a quiet drink.
Mrs. Hubbard paused for a moment, her eyes travelling from his stained football shirt to his suspicious bulge in the front of his filthy jeans, before making their way back up and coming to rest on a face of which a mother rat would be proud. Then she drew herself up to her full height and haughtily declared, I am a lesbian, before stalking out of the pub. Elsie grinned and practically skipped out the door, calling over her shoulder,
and I'm her wife.
Penny smiled weakly at the barman and shrugged. Me too? Then she beat her own hasty retreat. That evening, Detective Inspector Mitchell leaned back in his chair and regarded the packed social club. He wondered who was doing any actual policing tonight, as every officer in Aberdeen seemed to be here at his retirement due. Mind you, they'd done him proud. An excellent meal, rounded off by a toast from the Chief Constable of Police Scotland, who was enjoying the excuse to extract herself from the clutches of Tully Allen HQ and come home to see family, old friends and, of course, old colleagues. He'd trained her himself and was proud to see her rise from nervous probationer, cocking up her first arrest, through to assured politician, who somehow managed to stay on the right side of the press, the public, and the people who worked for her. D.I. Mitchell caught her eye and raised his glass, letting her know that he appreciated her speech. Finally, before the drinking began in earnest, D.I. Mitchell stood to make his own speech. He clinked a teaspoon on a glass, calling for silence. The hubbub died down a little, but many continued their conversations. He clinked again. Nothing. The chief constable stood up and roared, Quiet! Instantly, silence fell, and D.I. Mitchell cleared his throat.
Thank you, ma'am, and thank you all for coming tonight.
The D.I. spoke about memorable cases he had worked over the decades and the memorable colleagues with whom he had had the honour to serve. There was laughter at his account of sledging on riot shields in Duthie Park and the time that the whole unit turned up for a shift a little the worse for wear. The very disgruntled sergeant had sent them all outside for 10 minutes to get some fresh air. So they duly commandeered a police van and went in search of strong black coffee and a burger. An hour later, The same sergeant got a call to ask if someone could please come and get them because nobody could remember where they'd parked the van. Overall, D.I. Mitchell later reflected, the speech went down well, as did the copious amount of whiskey afterwards. The £200 he had put behind the bar was gone within the first half hour, and by the end of the second half hour, an air of relaxed bonhomie filled the room. By the end of the third hour, Aberdeen's finest were doing a drunken conga to DJ Utsi's Hey Baby, stopping only to thrust their hips at the ooh-ah parts. The problem being that some people were ooing when they should have been eyeing, resulting in several members being forcefully ejected from the conga by their colleagues, members. There will be a few harsh words come tomorrow, thought D.I. Mitchell, but I won't be there to hear them. Now, with the lights up and last orders called, only a few stragglers remained. The D.I. went in search of the manager to settle his tab and thanked him for a memorable night. He popped his head around the door of the office, but saw only a woman who he recognised as a member of the catering staff.
Sorry, he said, I was looking for Charlie.
He's just popped out for a smoke. He'll be back in a minute. You can come in and wait for him if you like, the woman offered.
D.I. Mitchell sidled into the small room, trying to squeeze his bulk past an aspidistra in a tall pot without knocking it over. He took a seat in one of the low leather visitors' chairs and smiled at the woman.
I'm John Mitchell. It was my retirement due tonight.
Congratulations, she said and held out a hand. Kerry Price, catering manager, and Charlie's partner. I hope you enjoyed the food.
Oh, aye,
said D.I. Mitchell, shaking her hand and nodding enthusiastically.
It was a good spread. I like that you sourced everything locally.
Thanks, you can't beat a bit of Angus beef.
Aye, and the cake was delicious.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.